Ladies and gentlemen, greetings from the China National Tourist Office, London, and thank you for joining us wherever you are. Welcome to Rediscover China in the UK. I am Xue Ling, Director of CNTO London, China National Tourist Office, London. I think I should start with house rules about language options. Okay, our talk today is presented bilingually in English and Mandarin Chinese. You can choose your language preference on the Zoom platform, which is something really new for us. I think on the main screen at the bottom, there is a function called interpretation. I think you may notice it's sort of like a map, right? Okay, by clicking the button, you can see the language options. If you choose off, you will hear the original sound of the talk, either in English or Mandarin Chinese, depending on the speaker. If you choose English, you will hear the English interpretation for the whole duration of the event. Likewise, if you choose Chinese, you will hear Chinese interpretation for the whole duration of the event. Please make the choice as you see fit. You may also read the instructions in the chat box. All right. Today's event is jointly presented or hosted by CNTO London, the UK Research and Development Center for Chinese Traditional Culture, and the China Travel Service and Information Center, with the support from the Cultural Section of the Chinese Embassy in the UK, and our supporters based in China, the Memorial Museum of Generalissimo Sun Yat-sen's mansion, Guangzhou Thirteen Hongs Museum, and the supporters based in the UK, the Society for Anglo Chinese Understanding, Make It China, OE Media, Cambridge China Center, China Minutes, Nouvelle d'Europe, China Hour, Amazing China, and the UK Shanxi Association. Thank you all. Our event today is live and open to the public. For those who missed it, a recorded version will be available afterwards on CNTO London's YouTube channel and WeChat channel. Now perhaps a few words for those first time audience, I mean members joining us. Rediscover China in the UK is a tailor curated brand created during the lockdown when international travels have been restricted. Both British and Chinese experts are gathered online, exploring Chinese culture and the historical legacies existing in the UK to help audiences to enjoy a deeper knowledge and understanding of Chinese culture, history, and tourism attractions before the restrictions of international travel are finally lifted. So far, CNTO London has the honor to have invited Dr. Francis Wood for two talks. The first, which is already, you see the trailer. And the second is actually Dr. Francis Wood in conversation with Mr. Emil Dabujin from the National Trust, entitled Chinese Wallpaper in the UK. So today, we shall join Dr. Francis Wood in conversation with specialists from both China and the UK from Pith paper painting to the 13 Hongs of Canton, sharing stories about the maritime Silk Road, which will be the third talk. So before coming back assisting Q&A session, I'm now handing over to Dr. Francis Wood to chair the talk and panel discussion. Francis, please.
Hello, it's a great pleasure for me to join you again for one of these great talks in the series, Rediscover China in the UK. We've had a great series of discussions so far, and today is a very rich program, I think, for you. I'm Francis Wood. I've been studying China for more than 50 years, and I'm still very passionate about all aspects of China, including paintings, and I'm especially fond of export paintings made in China specifically for sale to Western visitors. In the last lecture in this series, as Shirling mentioned, the topic was Chinese painted wallpaper, wallpapers made in China for European homes. And many grand National Trust houses still contain rooms that you can see decorated with birds, flowers, and garden scenes, all painted in China for the European customers of the 13 Hongs. And I think, is that right, that first of all, we're going to see a little demonstration of what the 13 Hongs are, what the 13 Hongs meant, and their position in the trade between China and Europe.
My name's 13, as in 13 Hongs. Between the 18th and 19th centuries, the Qing government appointed around 100 Chinese merchants to trade with the West through the so-called 13 factories, later known as the 13 Hongs in Guangzhou. As the kingdom's sole trading port, let me tell you the story of this about how they made their money. My name is 13, as in the 13 Hongs.
If that's not working too well, should we proceed straight to the meat of today's event?
Good morning, Francis. It's Alastair here.
Hi. The thing about the little documentary introduction is it explains about the very unequal method of trading between China and the West in the 18th, 19th, and early 20th centuries. But we are here more to celebrate one of the products of the 13 Hongs, if you like. What happened in Canton, in Guangzhou, was that many ships' captains and sailors and some other visitors came to the place, and in the days before postcards, before photographs, they wanted to take home illustrations of what they had seen, and what they had seen were wonderful things, a completely different civilization. And so you get the beginning of the export painting trade. Now, I had the great opportunity to visit Alastair Blackburn's house recently and met him and his wife, Wendy. The house is absolutely full of his collection of Chinese export art, not just paintings, but dark carved furniture, fans, ivory figurines, porcelain, but above all, paintings, especially Pith paper paintings. His house is a small museum devoted to the sort of art and handicraft sold by the 13 Hongs, a miniature 13 Hongs museum. Alastair and his wife have collected an enormous amount, visiting sales and antique shops throughout the UK, and have made a special collection of the thousands of Pith paper paintings, which were a special Chinese product, specifically produced in the Guangdong area for the export trade. And I'm delighted that Alastair is going to show us his collection through a series of illustrations. Welcome.
Good morning, Francis. Can you hear me okay?
Yep.
Nice to see you.
Please, can you begin your presentation?
And before I start, I've noticed that a few of my friends and relatives are online today, so I'd like to say a very special hello to my friends in Guangzhou, Hong Kong, and my family in Xi'an. So it's a big hello to you all. I haven't seen you for such a long time because of the pandemic. And looking forward to seeing you all again one day when things hopefully return to normal. Yes, it's a love story, Francis, of an Englishman meeting a Chinese lady here in the UK and developing an interest together and finding out a little bit more about each other's cultures. Next slide, please. So over the last 15 years or so, We started off in Portobello Antiques Market here in London. And then as we started to travel around Europe, we would visit antique shops, antique fairs, and we found these little paintings pretty much wherever we went. And of course, as you become more interested, we've been contacted by people from all over the world, in fact, from Chile to South Africa, the USA and Australia, and bought these paintings in varying different degrees of condition and brought them back to our house here in London. So my wife is Chinese, and as I said, through these appreciation of these paintings, we've been able to study the history and the relationship between our two countries. Next slide, please. Oh, back one, please. Go back one, please. No, back, not forward. Nope, you're still going forward. Go back, please. One more. One more back, please. There we go. So, yes, I'm not quite, I should introduce myself briefly. My name is Alastair Blackburn, but I also have a Chinese name by the name of Lao Bu. And I'm a businessman, and this is my part-time hobby that my wife and I share. So this morning I'm going to introduce you to some Pith paintings that I've collected, talk a little bit about where I found them and how I found them, and we'll go through a few of them as a presentation. Next slide, please. So the thing about Pith paper that represents a big challenge for a collector is the fact that the paper itself is extremely fragile. It's very thin and it's very brittle. And as such, it can get very easily damaged. My dear friend, Mr. Cheng, who's speaking to you later, will discuss, show you a little bit more about this. But as a result, the paintings have arrived, or we found them, in often poor condition. And we consider it our kind of responsibility, if you like, to try and stabilize them and conserve them, in the hope that we are just the temporary guardians of these paintings and that they've lasted 200 years. And we hope that they will last another 200 years for generations, future generations to enjoy. Next slide, please. Now, how they got to Europe is aboard ships that were carrying tea. The trade between China and the West in tea was a very large business indeed. And there would always be a little bit of space on those ships for other decorative items such as furniture, silver, porcelain, of course, but mostly it was about tea. And the dangerous journey, because this was before the Suez, long before the Suez Canal was opened, would be raced by the ship's captains in order to arrive at London first ahead of all the competition and therefore sell the very best and finest quality tea as a luxury product with a luxury price. Next slide, please. This would then be distributed to the wealthy families of around Europe, who would take great pleasure in having pieces from China. Chinese goods were considered a luxury item, and not least the finest selections of teas. And this slide shows some of the storage vessels or tea caddies that were used during the 18th and 19th century, to be found in the drawing rooms of wealthy families around the West. It's important to remember that China was, or Chinese goods were a luxury for most people, and that many of the population would never hope or could never hope to visit China. But the quality and of the artwork, from porcelain to silver, was much respected by buyers in the West. Next slide, please. So this is a watercolour on Pith paper showing the actual trading place between China and the West in the 18th and 19th century, and is the site of Mr. Wang's museum, but 200 years ago. It was the early form of a postcard so that people and the families and friends of the merchants who traded there would see where they were trading. So while the big ships were parked up the river at Whampoa, this is where the deals would be done and the samples tasted or viewed or what have you. And then the goods would be paid for and then shipped up to the larger ships parked in the anchorage at Whampoa a few miles up the road. Next slide, please. And it's fair to say that these artists were not prevalent just in Guangzhou, but here you can see a couple of representations of Macau looking from the south and the north. All of them were accurate representations of the towns in question. And one can see that because different versions of the same view will change over the years. And it is possible to age these paintings quite specifically, depending upon the architectural differences that might have appeared between one year to the next. Next slide, please. So the albums tended to arrive in sets of 12, covered in silk cardboard covers, such as you can see here, of varying sizes and qualities, I should say. The one on the bottom, the highly decorated light blue cover on the bottom, is rumored to have come from a luxury shop in Canton, which would deal only in luxury goods ranging from porcelain to china, and indeed including these paintings. And this branded cover could be likened a little bit to the Harrods shop in London with the dark green bag. And however, they weren't easy to demonstrate to friends and families when tucked away in an album. And the temptation became too much for the buyers to break up these albums and display the 12 paintings contained within these albums as paintings in their own right. But of course, the problem that then happened was that these paintings got firstly damaged, and secondly, scattered all over the world. Next slide, please. So as I said earlier, these paintings really represent postcards to families, friends, and other interested audiences in the West, and gave a view of China as a mystical country full of beautiful gardens. The traders were allowed restricted access to the gardens, the wonderful gardens that surround Guangzhou. And these would be stylized representations of beautiful Chinese ladies in traditional Chinese dress, somewhat stylized, but nevertheless giving this mystical appearance to the many and interested viewers and audiences in the West. Next slide, please. Now, as a collector and as an amateur, we've also come across these handmade Canton frames. And I confess that the paintings within the frames were never presented, but it's a bit of fun that we have is to take Pith paintings and remount them, stabilize them and conserve them and put them then into these handmade beautiful frames. Next slide, please. And here's some more examples where the frame was normally been found as a mirror. So it would have had a mirrored piece of glass in the middle, but that mirror often got damaged or stained. So we have taken out the mirror and replaced them with Pith paintings to create kind of works of art that we hope can be enjoyed. Well, we enjoy them and hopefully can be enjoyed by the people seeing them. Next slide, please. I think I have now nearly 1,500 paintings, although if I'm perfectly honest, I'm not entirely sure. And on two occasions during that, the 15 years that my wife and I have been collecting these paintings, I've been tempted to what I call in-paint. And what you see on this slide is on the right-hand side is the completed painting. But on the left-hand side, you can perhaps see that there used to be a very large hole right in the middle of the painting, which obviously detracted poorly from it. So in this particular instance, what we have done is taken some pith paper of the period and slipped it behind the hole and then painted on top of that pith painting and tried to match it up. I'll confess I'm not entirely happy with it, but it was our best effort to preserve this wonderful painting of what can only be a celebration of some festival in China on the river, and maybe the Spring Festival, with a regatta of boats, and one that I have to say is one of my favorites, and therefore I did do the in painting. But I don't normally. Next slide, please. It wouldn't be Chinese art if it didn't have some kind of mystery. And although most of the paintings are unsigned, having been painted by more than one artist and moved down a production line within the artist's studio, occasionally, and I have three paintings in my collection, the studio, and in this case, Sunhua, has actually signed his name in the very small portion of the leaf in the bottom right-hand corner. And it would be quite possible to view these paintings without noticing it. Next slide, please. Here's another one where it's a painting which we've mounted in one of our Canton frames of what is quite typically a court official or court representative. But at the back, at the bottom, beneath the legs of his chair, again, Mr. Sunhua has given us a view that this indeed did come from his studio. I know of only a few other examples where the painting is actually signed elsewhere in the world. Next slide, please. Now, this is one of my favorite paintings, and I'm not going to say too much about this because my dear friend, Mr. Cheng, is going to talk a little bit more about it. It shows the Canton Fire Service attending a fire, presumably in Guangzhou. And if we have time at the end of the presentation this morning, I'll talk with you about how I found this painting, because not only is it one of my favorites, but it has a rather extraordinary story behind it. Next slide, please. So auction houses in the West are not as familiar with this art as perhaps they should be. And quite often over the 15 years of collecting, I found that auction houses will list a painting completely incorrectly. This one was at an auction house in the middle of the country, which is normally selling farm machinery, and had this listed as a 20th century Japanese print, which is about as wrong as you can get, really, because it's not 20th century, it's not Japanese, and it's not a print, but rather a painting of one of the famous gardens around Guangzhou, with a couple of Chinese ladies, again in traditional dress, sat in the middle. We have, again, remounted it into a Canton-made Chinese frame. So it's a good day for a collector when such a listing happens, because no one is interested in a 20th century Japanese print. Next slide, please. So altogether, when you consider the collection from maybe 20 or so different subjects, ranging from 12 paintings concerning the harvesting and production of Chinese tea, to the various processions within Chinese society, as you see here, this one being for New Year. If you view the collection as a whole, one starts to see the multifaceted nature of the relationship between China and the West at that time. and put on top again, I repeat, the fact that China was considered a mystical, highly cultured, ancient civilization, you start to get a true understanding of what life may have been like in Canton at that time. Next slide, please. When the paintings are in their original albums, they are often accompanied by little scripts to the left of the painting, which explains a particular part of the album content. And I've selected a couple here this morning, which particularly I like. On the left, the explanations tells you that it is a couple of priests taking their prayers within a Canton temple. And on the right-hand side is a painting of a Westerner buying paintings in an artist studio in Canton. And the script very kindly doesn't miss a chance to promote the fact that they are the best studio in Canton, producing, and I quote, the finest rice paper paintings. So it was often, while the paintings were still in the albums, they were informative as well as decorative. Next slide, please. Occasionally, however, you come across some unusual subjects, and I wanted to show you a couple from my collection this morning. On the left-hand side is a Pith paper album, 12 paintings again, on Pith paper and surrounded by the Chinese silk mount that is normal, is a painting of a house, but it's actually situated here in the UK and is now, was a historic house, which is now part of the university town. And the rest of the 11 paintings are landscape scenes around this university building. So I can only imagine that a set of prints or engravings were taken of this historic house, that they were sent out to China, and the Chinese artist was commissioned to paint these paintings and then return them to the UK. On the right-hand side, this is clearly a representation of Chinese Day of the Dead, remembering one's ancestors, and gives, again, another insight into Chinese traditions and culture that would not necessarily have been well understood by people in the West. Next slide, please. This is all about the quality of the workmanship and the preservation of Chinese history. For a painting that is 200 years old, the delicacy of the brushwork can only be admired when studied up close and in situ. Next slide, please. Yes, my last slide this morning is to show the audience that it wasn't just the West that was present in Canton at the time, but that it was also many other cultures ranging from the Middle East and indeed the Philippines and other parts of Asia. And that altogether, the Canton community was of many nations and representing an important and interesting time that I continue to enjoy and read from the 19th century. Next slide, please. And that was a quick run through, Francis, of the collection that you saw the other day. Are you still there?
I'm still here. I enjoyed very, very much the chance to see so many of the lovely paintings again. And you've given us a very good scope, really, of, you know, covering everything from paintings of history through paintings of folklore, through paintings of dragon boat festivals and gardens and everything. It was absolutely wonderful. Really great chance to see the paintings again. As you say, the only thing that's wrong with a presentation like this is that the colours on the Pith paper are so bright and vibrant, and they take the paper itself, the Pith paper seems to take colour particularly well, and one really wants to get close to them. But that was a fantastic introduction. Thank you very much indeed. And now, to continue the exploration of Pith paper, we're going to go to one of Alastair's, I think, I believe a friend and colleague over many years, to hear about the actual material itself. These paintings on Pith paper were a special Chinese product made specifically in the Guangdong area for the export trade. And Cheng Zhongjie is the foremost expert on Pith paintings and the very unusual material that is used for them. So it's a great pleasure to introduce him to tell us about his research.
大家好，我给大家讲的是广州清代通草画的发现及研究。下一页，请翻下一页。第一部分介绍下广州外销通草画的重新发现。下一页，首先呢，我们一起来欣赏几幅通草画。 这是一张木棉花图，含苞待放的木棉花告诉我们，春天已经来临，万物复苏，一只美丽的喜鹊正在聚精会神地叼着昆虫，预示丰盛的午餐开始了。画面呢，栩栩如生，万物生机勃勃，预示着世界是如此的恬静而美丽。下一页。 这是一幅荔枝图，我们看这个画面，荔枝树上结满了火红红的荔枝，表明夏季已经到了，该是荔枝上市的火热的季节。相信我们今天在场的每一位观众看到如此新鲜的荔枝，一定是很想去尝一尝。下一页，请翻下一页，这是一幅侍女的吹月图。 在我们静静的欣赏它的演奏时，我们相信它一定是一位非常出色的演奏家。下一页，请翻下一页。大家一定会问，这是什么画？这些画为什么那么美丽？首先呢，我们需要了解什么是通草画。19世纪出版的中文典籍里出现有通子画或者通画的记载。 这些就是我们今天要介绍的一种画作。这类画作被带到欧美各地后，由于它的材质松软、体轻且富有弹性，色白有光泽，但是非常容易折断，被当地的民众误以为这是中国人用大米做成的一种纸。于是呢，在欧美获得了有米纸画的美名。其实，通草画的绘画材料是一种柿子。 但非人工造纸，而是直接采自一种五加科植物，名叫通托木，俗名通草的精髓，是手工艺人用刀切割而成。这里我可以给大家展示一下这个通草木的精髓。那么通过这个由艺人把它切割出来，是吧？就是一层层的一个一片片的。这个我们今天所看到的这个画面，就是在这上面的通草片上来。 进行这个描绘，这种植物主要分布在中国的台湾、福建、广西、云南、贵州、四川、湖南、湖北、江西等地。伦敦的皇家植物园的水晶屋里也培植有这种植物。由于通托木的精髓粗细有限，人工切割时是要受这个切割技艺的影响。 因此呢，每张通草片呢也只有我们人的手掌那么大小，这就使得通草画的尺幅不大。啊，这是我们看到下一页，这是通托木。再下一页，这是在贵州省贵定县。 所看到的这个通托木的这个树，这是02年。再下一页， 这是当地的师傅这个切割出来的这个通托木，从这个树心里面通托木的精髓，在下也。 这是师傅的切割过程，正在切割，在下也，这是切的过程，在下也。广州的通草画呢，兴起于19世纪20年代，大约是消失于20世纪的20年代，流行了100年的历史。 后来呢，却销声匿迹的也100年的历史。那么，他又是如何被发现的？这里我们需要讲一段这个历史的起源，也就是这段精彩的故事成就了中英两国民间友好交往的一段佳话。20世纪90年代，当时在广州市文化局分管广州市文物保护和博物工作的副局长陈玉环女士，她是一位文博工作者。 土生土长的广州人，1995年夏，他受邀前往牛津大学中国研究所访学。期间，他在牛津大学波德利恩图书馆查看到一批19世纪广州制作的绘画作品，尺幅不大，色彩却异常的亮丽。为了方便日后的研究，他向图书馆定制了这篇画作的幻灯片。几年后，家住叶克郡的伊凡威廉斯先生为查看这批绘画。 也造访了该图书馆，并在登记册上看到了这位来自广州、和他有着相同兴趣的学者。于是，伊凡先生通过北京的一位朋友，也就现在的中国博物馆协会的理事长，要到了这位副局长的联系地址，并主动联系，从此拉近了广州与叶克郡的距离。双方建立了深厚的友谊。随着日后的进一步交往， 也促成了2001年冬的一场有着特别意义的捐献活动。伊凡先生向广州市捐献了60幅的通草画，为使广州博物馆于2001年的9月举办了特别的展览《西方人眼里的中国情调》，伊凡威廉斯捐献19世纪广州外销通草纸水彩画。由于这次展览 举办成功且影响巨大，伊凡先生在离开广州返回英国前，决定再向广州捐献了10幅通草画，从此广州也拥有了第一批通草画的产品。下一页，这是左上图是伊凡先生和他的夫人，左下图是 2001年9月，这个举办的这个展览的开幕仪式。下一页，此后在众多爱心者的支持下，广州收藏的通草画也越来越多，比如英吉华人、赵台来先生向广州博物馆、广州的宝墨园捐赠的数百幅通草画。参加今天讲座的王恒先生及其夫人冯杰女士向孙中山大元府纪念馆、广州十三行博物馆捐赠的近千幅的通草画。如今在广东省内的许多博物馆以及中国沿海的一些博物馆都收藏有不少的通草画。下一页，请翻下一页。接下来我介绍一下通草画的研究情况。 下一页，通草画反映的内容呢非常丰富，题材繁多，有花鸟虫鱼、港口的庭院、市井风情、戏剧表演等等。这些画作深受欧洲绘画技巧的影响，与中国传统绘画风格有别。不仅的画面优美，色彩异常的鲜光亮丽、层次分明，富有极强的立体感。 而且内容的写实性强，是当时社会生活的真实写照。这些画作也显示出新生的艺术魅力，是典型的中西合璧作品。近20年来，通草画的研究情况呢，大体上可划分为2个阶段。下一页。 第一个阶段是新千年初的十年，在这个阶段研究的重点是炭草通草画的材质及其新圈的历史。2001年我们虽然成功举办了有关通草画的第一个展览，但是有许多问题却没有得到解决，特别是关于这种神秘的绘画材质是如何生产的，当时是完全不知道。到2002年我通过互联网了解到中国贵州省贵地县生产的一种材料有可能是通草画的载体，于是我前往贵州省贵地县做调研。在这次调研中我确定了清代广州外校通草画就是使用贵定县生产的这种材料。随后我们邀请英国友人伊凡先生前来中国实地考察。这一年的冬天，伊凡先生在英国一家基金会的资助下前来中国，和我们一起前往贵州省贵定县，便在当地通草切割师傅王玉龙先生的带领下，我们深入大山的深处实地考察了通草的生产环境及当地百姓收割制作通草片及销售的情况。这一重要的发现为我们进一步打开通草画的密码是提供了一把很关键的钥匙。从此我们认识到在中国历史上，中国古代劳动人民早在春秋战国时期就对通草有了认识，懂得用通草做中药、制作人造花等等，如今这些功能依然是存在的。下一页。2011年，中国中央电视台探索发现栏目于国际博物馆日期间，以通草奇画为题对通草画做了专题的报道，这是通草画首次在中国中央电视台亮相。那么在这一阶段的学术成果可以参考2001年出版的《西方人眼里的中国情调》，伊凡·威廉斯捐赠19世纪广州外侨通草纸水彩画，和2008年出版的《19世纪中国外侨通草水彩画研究》。下一页。第二个阶段就是2011年以来的十年，应该是通草画研究的第二个阶段。在这个阶段里，人们的研究视野是更加的开阔，研究的角度也更为深入，归纳起来主要体现在三个方面。第一，人们开始用科学仪器对通草画中这画的使用的颜料做了测试的分析。第二，是一批美术爱好者积极在探索通草画技，并努力复兴当代的通草画。第三，史学爱好者将通草画作为历史文本做出了更深入的解读。那么在这一阶段的选取成果可以参考2014年出版的《广州制作欧美藏19世纪中国通草画》，和2015年出版的《王恒冯杰抗力捐赠通草画》。下一页。请翻下一页。通草画所反映的内容呢非常丰富，今天呢我在这里仅谈两个方面。第一个是通草画的一些画面的内容是传递了中国人的真善美的一些观念。在广州外销通草画中，一些画作在销往欧美市场的同时，也在向西方世界无声地传递了中国人对美好生活的向往以及对真善美的追求。比如在画面中看到的鸳鸯图、鸟儿成双成对图，都代表了中国人颂扬纯洁、金真、自由的爱情。下一页。这是一对鸟，再看下一页。劝导世人戒赌徒、戒食鸦片徒、禁吸制纸徒以及行善徒，也表达了中国人崇尚文明、扬善成物的美好的愿景。再看下一幅。美丽的乡村图、雅致的居士图也显示了中国人热爱生活、热爱家园的情趣。再看下一图。其次， 通常化也呈现出文明交融的成果。清朝乾隆以来，伴随珠江三角洲社会经济的发展和广州对外贸易的繁盛，广州因独特的地理优势得领封建之先，许多极具西洋色彩的物品率先进入广州，比如新型的消防车，广州人叫的水车，即是一例。早年广州人灭火的方式呢是相当的原始。1800年，沙利文多尔描绘了一场火灾，为了灭火，中国人费了很大力气把一个重重的神像搬到了火场。据记载，最严重的火灾发生在1822年的11月1日，傍晚的时分，广州三管区以北 1.5 英里突然起火，24小时后所有三管都被大火烧毁。此后周期性的火灾威胁着三管，广州的旗杆也不断鼓吹火灾保险。1835年春天，苦力已经接受了西洋救火方法的训练，并使用进口设备，火灾得到了很大遏制。下一页，请翻下一页。目前我们见到了有四幅救火题材的通草画，其中有三幅是反映广州十三行三管区附近救火的场景，内容分别有居民搬迁、这个逃避避火图、救火队员扛着梯子挑水桶，以及救火人员推着水火车救火图。画面显示，当广州十三行的三管区附近发生火灾时，居民乘坐运货波艇纷纷地逃离避火。有一支标明为十三行西山的救火队员熟练地扛着梯子，挑着水桶，手推火车奔赴火灾现场救火。还有一幅通草画是许文抗力收藏，反映着广州附录里救火的情景。救火员身着统一的服饰，佩戴统一的腰带，他们有分工，显示着这是一支专业的消防队伍。水车有四个轮子，承载着一个大木柜箱，大木柜箱的正中竖立一个长方形的立体的木柜，正面写有十三行水车的字样。立体木柜的中间横穿着两根铁棒，应该是杠杆，用来压水棒，把柜里的水喷射出来。在它的顶部还设有一个出水口，用来接着水枪。这时的水车还设有接驳帆布的水龙的一个进水口。请翻下一页。这里显示的消防车是应该是一种新式的消防设施，是英国工业革命的产物，是伴随着中西文化交流进入广州的。请翻下一页。这一幅图，这面是有十三行的水车的画的字样。请翻下一幅。请翻下一页。据文献记载，早在鸦片战争爆发前，广州十三行的行商已经从国外进口，并在自己的庭院里使用这种新式的水车。1836年，距离广州十三行三馆300码内的木匠广场发生了一场大火，烧掉上百家的店铺。当时的行商如明光及富甲天下的浩光、吴炳健就拥有这种新式的水车。明光送来的救火机及水车来到广场，并且配备了很好的人员，操作得很好。浩光的行商因为有五部从英国进口的极好的消防水车，在不经意的大量的喷水而幸免于难。这种新式消防制度以及新式的消防设施在中国一直沿用到20世纪初。早期的水车主要是从国外进口，后来慢慢的发展到广州自产。请翻下一页。这里介绍的还有一件物品属生活用具，是室内的灯吊灯。我们看这个图的左上方，这个亭子里吊着一盏这个吊灯， 请翻下一页。根据美国的学者雅克丹斯写的《黄金圈驻地：广州的美国商人群体和美国对华政策的形成1784至1844年》，在这里面有一段记录，这样亲密的关系同样出现在美国人和行外商人之间，互相交换商业信息，在向北国拖欠债务的人追回债务方面提供帮助，其他表达友谊的证明非常普通，就是一些礼物。威廉姆斯1836年写给他在纽约的兄弟的信中，要求他购买一对吊灯，价格在350到500美元之间。他详细说明，这两盏灯必须尽可能的华丽，上面要有大量的雕花、镀金的装饰，带有长长的玻璃悬挂物，形成三角形的形状等等。这是给木星的一个礼物。下一页。最后我们来谈一下我们的展望。通爪画作为形象记录的历史，在沟通中西文明方面曾起到了非常重要的作用，也为我们研究19世纪的中国与世界历史提供了一份十分珍贵的图像资料。因此我们深信，随着学术研究的深入展开，通爪画将在未来沟通中西文明方面会继续发挥作用。同时我们也呼吁大家一起努力，积极申报将通爪画纳入世界记忆名录。谢谢。
That was wonderful, thank you. It was a great pleasure too to see the link between the two papers, Alistair's firefighting and then that whole story taken up by Mr. Cheng, and also the fact that really it's a revival of Pith paper painting. It's a great thing to see something that was so popular in the past being promoted again in such an interesting way. And now we know a little bit more about the manufacture of the Pith paper. I'm very happy to introduce Wang Heng 先生, who is the curator of the Guangzhou Thirteen Hongs Museum and himself a great collector of Chinese export art. His efforts in Guangzhou parallel Alistair's enthusiasm in the UK. Both are passionate about Guangzhou export art. And Wang is in a sense returning Chinese export art to its original home, whilst Alistair is preserving it in its intended destination in his museum. So we are, in this case, we are discovering Chinese art intended for the UK, but in China. So we're going backwards and forwards with Canton export production. And it's my great pleasure to introduce Wang Heng. Thank you.
Hello, 大家好，哎，各位女士，各位先生，大家好。今天很荣幸给大家分享一下十三行博物馆还有我的收藏。下一页。首先介绍一下我。这里上一页，首先介绍一下我的情况啊，我叫王恒，我呢就是20几年前我就开始收藏十三行的文物了，我除了收藏十三行的文物之外呢，我还收藏那个音响，就是所以因为我是生产音响设备的，所以呢我也自己也搞了一个音响博物馆，我的音响博物馆呢，就从最早的八音盒、留声机啊，一直到最现代的舞台音响啊，都有展示。下一页。 我在这里先介绍一下十三行博物馆。十三行博物馆呢是2016年正式在十三行的遗址上面重新建立出来的。它有两层啊，其中一层呢就是介绍十三行博物馆的十三行的历史啊，第二层呢主要是我专赠给十三行博物馆的文物的展示。里面呢说实话有很多当年十三行的文物啊，其中有什么通草画、广彩啊、牙雕啊、扇子啊、家具啊等等啊，总共现在博物馆呢应该超过5000件文物了。这里呢说实话也是很感谢我们许文理事和老布先生，他其实也为我们十三行啊专了很多通草画给我们十三行。我们这个十三行博物馆到目前为止据我所知全中国国营的博物馆里面唯一一家 99% 的文物都是靠私人专赠的。下一页。这是我自己搞的博物馆啊，叫音响世界音响发展史博物馆。这里呢就是全部就是展示了音响的发展历史的各种留声机啊、八音盒啊，还有什么唱机啊、收音机之类啊，有时间欢迎大家过来可以指导。下一页。关于通草画，我们刚才也听了两位老师的介绍，通草画呢他们已经很尝试的介绍，我在这里呢就大概说一说我们十三行博物馆收藏的有几张比较特别的通草画啊。这一套通草画呢就是那个茶叶的茶叶买卖呀、还有加工过程的一套通草画。我们在这套通草画里面呢就发现了有20多种就各种各样的茶叶的名称啊，我们也对这些茶叶的名称做过研究啊，很多呢现在我还有销售的啊，但是呢有4-5种啊已经在市场找不到了，我们一直呢还在找看这个到底这些茶叶的名称好像什么洞宾啊，这些是龙珠啊，到底是什么地方产的啊？对我们研究清代茶叶外销啊，我认为啊，这个通草画还是很有帮助的。下一页，这一幅呢就是也是通草画，它是线描的通草画，是在我收藏通草画也超过10年了啊。我们博物馆呢我是唯一见到的一本就是线描的通草画啊，这个它的画工特别精细，总共一本有60张啊，60张，而且呢每一张呢上面呢都有写的名字啊，它到底是用。什么意思啊，这个画的意思是什么意思啊，它上面呢都有说，总共60幅。我估计啊它这些可能是当时的画稿来的估计。下一页。这个呢也是在我们收藏的一本通草画里面的一个广告纸啊。这个就是看得到啊，这个淮远义永泰兴通草画这个画册呢，其中呢他们这个淮远义啊总共有30多种就是或者是就不同题材的通草画给顾客选购。对，下一页。这个就是永泰兴通草画的一个也是一本通草画啊。这个通草画呢最关键呢是有一幅和就附了一幅 一封荷兰语写的信。这封信呢大概是 是雅加达写给荷兰那边的啊，大概是1881年写的这封信啊，上面呢就说了这些通草画都是很珍贵的画，就很特别很珍贵，你要好好保管。大概意思是这样啊，这个因为有些文字的我也不是很懂，所以呢就是大概的意思都是问候语啊，还有说这个通草画是很珍贵的东西，画一样呢就是这个意思吧大概。下一页。这个就是他的信啊，这个就是荷兰语的信啊，雅加达。很奇怪，他是可能是十三行运到雅加达，雅加达印尼的雅加达啊，再从雅加达运到荷兰，所以呢这个呢就是就是很纠结，很就是很多转了很多地方才转到荷兰的一幅一套通草画啊。这个呢就是也是一封信啊，这个是英国人写的一封信啊，上面呢就是有那个通草画剪贴出来的贴在信上面。因为这些英文呢、是100多年前的英文了，我们也找过人来翻译，现在说实话现在还不知道，不知道里面写什么意思，因为不怎么懂这些英文。希望呢我们的听众啊或者是观众啊能够帮帮我们啊。下一页。这一幅也同样，这个也是英文的一个通草画贴通草画的一封信，上面应该是一首诗来的啊，一个诗人啊，1830年写的一封信，也是证明呢就是当年的通草画呢是作为好像一个明信片一样，就送给友人的一个很好的一个明信片吧。下一页啊，通草画呢我就不说这么多了，我就也介绍一下十三行博物馆的藏品，其他藏品。其实十三行时期啊，当年我们外销的东西非常多啊，从我们什么刺绣啊，牙雕啊，还有什么广彩瓷器啊，还有什么扇子之类，各种各样啊，所以十三行博物馆呢基本上呢都有展示啊。这些家具呢十三行收藏了大概有100多件的那个家具，这些家具都是当时欧洲人按照他们的要求广州给他们生产的家具，所以现在我们叫 ODM 还是 OEM 的产品来的啊。现在其实我们等于是十三行时代的时候已经就是来料扎工了，我听说有些木材还是全部是进口的，我们这里的木材主要都是从东南亚进口，也有听说也有欧洲进口来我们中国，在这里加工成家具再运回欧洲啊，欧美也有这种的。对，所以呢这种家具呢它的风格都很西洋式。其实这种家具的风格最后其实在乾隆时期啊甚至是影响到宫廷的家具，所以我们在故宫里面见到很多家具都很有西洋风，其实就是我们广州的那个工匠啊去了北京啊，给他们就是制作了很多有西洋风格的家具。下一页。这是一个漆器屏风啊，这很大，这个漆器屏风应该有7米多宽啊，有2米3高啊，很大。它这个屏风呢是用漆用黑漆描金的手法来制作出来的。漆器其实在十三行时期呢欧洲人是非常喜欢的啊。在康熙时候就已经开始大量的外销去欧洲。 我们这幅屏风啊，都是画的，都是我们当时广州的一些风土人情啊，上面。市啊，就是买菜买东西的集市啊，还有码头啊，各种各样的场景啊，上面都有啊，所以很精彩。下一页，这个呢就是吕洪台，其实当年就是欧洲人呐、啊，也下一些图纸过来我们广州，就是按照他们的要求啊，生产他们需要的东西。好像这个吕洪台呢就很典型，是就为欧洲人生产的。下一页，这里呢我就讲讲广彩啊，就是十三行博物馆呢，其实收藏的广彩应该也有六七百件有啊，有六七百件。其实广彩这个产生呢，也是根据那个欧洲人的要求来生产的。他当时他的材料也是，从欧洲进来，他是所以最早才康熙雍正时候的广彩啊，主要都是进口的珐琅料，所以那时候，的广彩是特别精美。现在说实话，现在还拍卖价还挺贵的。刚刚去年在香港拍卖了一个花瓶啊，广彩的花瓶，是雍正的，拍卖了应该是超过六百万的一个花瓶啊。其实这个广彩这个加工，我认为还影响到宫廷里面的珐琅彩的那些。工艺其实对我们宫廷里面的珐琅彩、啊、也是有很大的影响啊。再下一页，这个呢就是一个道光时候的一个广彩的大碗啊，它上面呢就是有那个徽章啊，有一个文章就是一个家族定做的啊，这里写的是1832年啊，道光时候的一个广彩，一个徽，就是家族定做的一个广彩碗啊，这个潘翠碗。这里呢就介绍下一页啊，这里呢就是介绍一下就是。这一对就是洛克菲勒的冰钟，叫冰钟啊。这个一看这个形状，大家都知道，这个肯定是外国人定做的，那个一个瓷器啊。它下面呢是放冰的，听说是应该它用法是这样：下面是放冰，上面呢是放水果之类的啊，一个冰钟啊。这个叫干嘛叫洛克菲勒呢？瓷呢，听说因为是就是洛克菲勒家族收藏过这些瓷器，所以呢因为它是广彩里面最高档的一种瓷器啊，你看它全部都是真金描出来的，那金色的全都是真金，而且呢它的画面啊都很精美，画得很精美啊。下一页，这是一套就是洛克菲勒瓷的餐具啊。这些餐具呢，我知道呢，最多的一套这个洛克菲勒餐具啊，有200多件一套啊，最多的啊。但是洛克菲勒我们估计啊，的存世量可能也就是1万件左右，估计不会很多。而且呢，我们发现这个洛克菲勒瓷呢，最大的特点是怎么样呢？每一个瓷器的画面都不一样的，没有一个一样，是吧？所以证明，而且都很精美，画的都很精美，所以证明啊，这些瓷器都是肯定是一些画家来参与创作的啊，非常精美。现在在市场上很难见得到，只能在那些大的拍卖，拍卖的时候才会有出现这种 洛克菲利瓷啊，所以是很珍贵的瓷器。我在这里呢我也介绍一下啊，这个呢就是也是广彩啊。这个广彩呢大家也可以看得到，其实它的内容啊很特别。你看看，其实在乾隆时期啊，欧洲人呢其实对我们中国人的生活啊，他们就是感觉我们这里是很好的啊，这个就是一个天堂的一个地方差不多。但是那时候呢也没有一个，就是没有相机嘛，是不是啊，照相机也没有，所以呢我们呢就只能通过一些这个画啊，或者是瓷器啊，上面画我们中国人的生活场景啊。这里呢这个生活场景呢就是合家欢啊。这合家欢呢就是上面呢就是有男的有女的啊，有大人有小孩啊，一家人就是乐融融的在一起啊，一起玩啊，就一起休闲啊，后面有房子啊，有山啊，是吧？所以呢这个画面呢就是欧洲人看了以后啊都应该很羡慕我们的生活。下一页啊，这里呢就是其实我们时尚博物馆除了收藏这个广彩之外呢，其实很重要的一部分呢就是铜胎画珐琅啊。铜胎画珐琅呢我们应该有100多件总共。铜胎画珐琅传入我们中国，如果我们现在的研究呢应该从康熙开始啊传入我们十三行，就是传到广州。后来呢就是这种技术呢后来就是直接就传到宫廷。所以呢宫廷的画珐琅呢也发展起来了。可能上两个月香港佳士得不是拍卖了一个茶壶啊，一个画珐琅的茶壶，就拍了1000多万啊，一个画珐琅的茶壶。所以这种技术也材料跟技术都是从欧洲传过来的。所以证明就是其实我们十三行呢真的是一个中外的一个交流中心啊，一个包括艺术的啊，包括产品的啊，一个交流中心。下一页，这一个呢就是康熙时候的珐琅啊，画珐琅啊，大家都看得到这个珐琅非常精美啊，这个它这些珐琅料全都是进口的，因为我们中国能够自己开始生产珐料，那是从雍正开始应该才开始有珐琅材料出来。对，外国的珐琅材料还是当时还是真的是比较好。所以你看看这个碟，这个碟很大，有43公分大啊。它后面大家可以看看后面都画得很漂亮很精美，是吧？它不单只前面画得好，连后面真的非常讲究这个碟。下一页啊，这个呢是雍正时候的一个铜胎画珐琅啊，也是非常精美啊。这个内容叫三娘教子啊，这个三娘教子呢也是我们中国的传统文化啊，就是怎么样，就是做母亲啊，怎么样来教育孩子，怎么样把他抚养成人啊，成才啊，这个都是就是这个故事啊。大家可以看看到后面这个叫胭脂红啊，这种胭脂红啊当时是非常珍贵的，它是用黄金磨成粉，很细的粉啊，做颜料啊削出来的，它才可以出，就是那个这种胭脂红啊才能出这种红色。所以 非常珍贵啊，就好像珐琅彩也好，珐琅铜胎化珐琅还有瓷胎化珐琅，只要有胭脂红的都非常珍贵啊，主要都是宫廷里面的瓷器用。下一页，这里呢就再介绍就是银器，其实当时的十三行时期呢，除了刚才出的什么茶叶啊，那些家具啊瓷器之外呢，其实银器也是很大量的外销的啊。这个瓷器呢，这个银器啊，确实有很我们时常出去的很有中国的特色，所以呢就是也是很受欧洲人的欢迎的。下一页，这一套呢就是当年的那个银器啊，银器的一套茶壶，喝茶的东西啊，这个很有中国风的一套茶具。我在这里呢我也给大家看一看这个呢就是一个什么呢，就是金真金啊，金蕾丝的一个手链啊，在这个应该是乾隆时期的啊，这个乾隆时期他用那个金丝啊，非常细的金丝啊，垒出那个就是各种图案啊，这里是龙啊凤啊那个吉祥的图案出来啊，中间这些呢就是玳瑁啊，玳瑁这玳瑁呢就只有可能是两公分乘 1.5 公分大，但是上面呢就采用了很多圆雕的技法，圆雕的技法雕出了花卉啊，还有那些人物啊场景啊，这真的是非常精美啊。所以可以这样说，当时就是十三行时代，是十三行是全世界的奢侈品中心啊，其实是很有道理的。大家看看这个手链啊，就知道它的奢侈啊。下一页啊，这个呢七丝船也是银做的七丝船，因为当时欧洲人很喜欢我们的一些战船啊这些的题材的银器啊，这个也是很多出口的。下一页，这个是扇子，就是扇子呢其实在康熙雍正时候已经大量的已经外销欧洲的了，已经啊，其实鼎盛的时期呢应该是乾隆跟嘉道时期啊，这两把扇子呢都是嘉道时期的扇子哦。它呢是用那个贝壳啊，贝壳来做出来的啊。下一页啊，这个就是象牙扇子啊，这个象牙扇这是乾隆时候的，这也是你看有个徽章啊，这是欧洲家族啊，欧洲的贵族啊专门来这里定做的一把扇子，那个象牙扇子。这象牙扇子呢非常薄啊，它真的可能就只有两张纸这么薄啊，这种工艺啊可以这样说现在失传了，现在也不能做了，现在对，而且呢可以雕得非常细啊，这真的是真的 很值得我们现在就是可以看一看的这个。我在这里呢我也给大家看一看啊，其实 这把扇子啊，这个扇子呢就是一个漆描金象牙面的一个扇子，它有多少个人物啊，总共有两面加起来有98个人物啊，每一个人物呢他的脸呢都是用那个象牙片在象牙片做而且呢在上面画的，所以呢看起来呢那个人脸啊特别就逼真啊，就是它的立体感特别强， 还有一个呢，大家也可以看得到啊，这种扇子的颜色特别鲜啊，应该这个超过是170年了，这种扇子它的颜色还这么鲜艳，其实呢这些呢是当年呢采用了矿物料有关，所以呢这个矿物料啊，真的是可以说上千年都不会变颜色的。那现在我们用的很多颜料呢，过说实话十来二十年呢，基本上就快开始褪色的了。好，下一页，就是刺绣啊，就是十三博物馆呢，其实也有就收藏了各种广绣啊、刺绣啊，应该超过有一百多件了，应该说啊，对，各种各样的刺绣。刺绣呢，也是我从欧洲的博物馆那里看呢，应该从康熙时候，我们广州的刺绣啊，已经开始外销到欧洲了，已经，啊，其实这个开始的时候呢，就很多是以什么，那些。披肩啊，或者是那些台布啊那些为主啊，后来呢就是有做了很多窗帘啊，还有呢欧洲人呢也很喜欢收藏我们的刺绣的衣服。下一页啊，这幅广绣呢非常精美啊，这个应该是我们看它应该是道光时候大概是。啊，大家可以看得到这幅刺绣啊，它里面很多鸟，我们说这种题材呢叫五常图啊，五常什么叫五常图呢？我们中国人的五常呢就是夫妻啊、父母、兄弟姐妹孩子啊，就是就叫五常，就是。就还有朋友，就是这五类的人呢，我们怎么和睦相处啊，这个意思啊，所以呢这很有意义的。而且呢欧洲人也特别喜欢啊这种鸟类的这种题材，所以呢我们广州的人，广州的那些艺术家呢，就是把这些结合在一起啊，把我们中国元素啊通过刺绣的手法呢就是结合外国人的要求啊，就是做了很多艺术品出去啊。大家也可以看得到呢，就是我们刺绣啊，可能因为你这里的图片太小了，其实我们广绣还有一个很大的特点呢，就针法非常的多啊，因为我们要表现每一个部位啊，像鸟啊人的部位的时候，它都需要就不同的针法来表现出来，还有那一个色彩特别鲜艳，很丰富啊。下一页、哦、下一页这个就是就是也是一个民国时候的广绣的一个衣服啊，大家也看得到这个是很有就是我们广绣风格的一个衣服啊。今天呢我的分享就到这里，如果大家呢要想就是了解更多我们当年十三行那些文物的话，可以到我们十三行博物馆啊。谢谢，我到此结束，谢谢大家。
Thank you very much indeed. I mean, that was a wonderful trip through the variety. I mean, we've seen before the variety of contents of the paintings, but now we've spread into so many other areas, furniture, silver, silk, and so on. I'm always very amused. You showed a wonderful silver tea set where you have a teapot, but people say, how can you tell it's for foreigners? Well, because it has milk and sugar. You know, you wouldn't have a milk jug if you were in China, but it's been beautifully made in China specifically for export. Anyway, we've got some time, a little time, if any of our three experts would like to expatiate on export. And perhaps I might ask Alastair to start off, perhaps telling, can you tell us something about your future plans? Where are things going from here?
Yeah, before I do that, Francis, I'd like to share with you a couple of stories of collections along the way. One refers to the painting that my friend Mr. Cheng showed you about the fire engine. And I'd like, if I may, just to indulge me for a moment on how I found that painting, which was actually on eBay, which is an online auction site better known for electronics and clothing and household goods, and was clearly part of a house clearance. Anyway, after I acquired the painting of the Canton Fire Service, I contacted the seller to find out a little bit about where he got it from. And I had a phone conversation with him. And it turns out this was a youngish Chinese man who was clearing the house contents of his sadly recently deceased mother, who was a Chinese lady living in East London. And he'd come to clear her house after her death and took a mirror off the wall. And as he took the mirror off the wall, the back of the mirror fell away onto the floor. And behind it was that painting that you saw Mr. Chen describe. And one can only sit and wonder about the story that happened, that arose, that allowed this painting, to arrive in this place. And the other one I have, if I can show you, is a pair of little Pith paintings of birds. And I'm reminded again of a comment that Mr. Chen made about the pairs of birds showing love, because there you can see a very small pair of birds. They're identical, but they're actually in pure silver frames. And behind there, you can actually see the hallmark if you're close. And it's quite clear that these were given as maybe an anniversary present or a birthday present between a husband and a wife as a token of everlasting love. And again, I just wanted to share with you that particular piece, because it's never about the piece itself. It's often about the story behind it.
And what about your future plans with these wonderful paintings?
Well, that's a very good question, Francis. We are lucky enough to live in a large house. But as you said at the start of our talk, that house is now full. And the both of us, our children are grown up and moved on. And it would be nice to see a good home for them, because it's certainly been part of my life and my wife's life for the last 15 plus years. And I hope that they are enjoyed by future generations as much as she and I have enjoyed them.
Do you still collect?
I do occasionally. There's not much of it around, if I'm honest. Most of it has been probably taken by my good friend, Mr. Wang Hong.
Exactly.
So there's very little to find, and that which is around is normally a fairly low quality. I do collect occasionally, but only very occasionally now.
And Zheng Xianzhang, thank you very much for your talk. I wanted to ask you a little more about the Tongcao. I mean, what else is it used for? You mentioned medicine and artificial flowers. So is there still a thriving industry producing Tongcao?我刚才就是问，就是Tongcao，现在还出产吗？有什么作用？你说是用做窑、钟窑和绘画，而且也有其他的吗？
是不是问我呀？ 问您，对，还有很多通草的作用啊，功能很多，除了刚才说到的人造花，其实还可以做盆景，就是盆景呢，这个还可以做这种通草的堆画，就把它剪贴，然后像一幅立体的画，同时呢，还可以 用来做钓鱼的钓鱼竿的那个浮标， 还可以给小学生做一些课件上的 很多这个用途。这通草的功能和作用其实比我们想象的超出我们想象的，就它还有衍生的很多很多的这个内容。可能今天时间关系，我没有太多时间给一一来介绍。
你还要说什么关于通草吗？还是你都说完了吗？你还要告诉我们关于通草，还有一些事情你要说？
我刚才在讲座里面其实已经谈到了，就是通草的这个在文明交流方面是起到非常这个重要的一个作用。其实我的这个愿望呢，就很希望能够这种的新一种画种能够让更多的人这个了解它的这个价值。刚才这个老布先生也介绍了那幅这个很多人在救火的场景。我在想，按照这个当年的通草画的这个画的这个当年的这个风格来讲，应该说不仅仅是这一幅，应该是一组。这个当年的这个外销出去，它应该是成册来卖的，所以我想至少还有十一幅，就是类似这个救火的一个整个一个完整的一个画面。所以我很希望这个老布先生能够再继续努力，把另外十一幅也帮我们找到。
王先生，
你好。
Thank you very much for your, I'll do English and Chinese if I may,
你好你好
your collection. One of the things I found quite fascinating about your collection is that, you know, as I said, you are collecting items that were made to be sent away from China and you're bringing them back. How do you collect? Is it through travel or eBay like Alistair? How do you manage to collect Chinese export items and so widely? 听得懂吗？我就是问你，你怎么能收藏？就是中国为这些东西就是为了出口而做，而且您在中国，你怎么买？
对，这样，我收藏先说我干嘛收藏这个十三行的东西啊？我当时呢，我其实很早我就在收藏家具啊。当时呢，就发现呢有一个什么呢？我们中国人基本上不收藏当时我们十三行外销的文物，基本上不收藏啊。所以我想呢，我是广州人，是吧？我一定要收回我们广州的一些本土文化的东西。所以呢，我就留意到，这个就是十三行这种文物啊，就是好像广彩呀、啊。那些通草画这一类的就没有人收藏，所以呢我就开始收藏这一类东西。后来就是越收藏就越多，更多呢就是13年的时候呢，我看到十三行博物馆呢要建馆了，他们需要征集文物。我看哎呀，我这么多这个东西其实放在那个十三行博物馆里面是最好的，可以给大家可以分享这些精美的文物，所以呢我就把这些文物呢就捐给了十三行博物馆啊。通草画呢，我的收藏呢其实真的没有，当时真的没有留意它，因为它这是很小众的一个一种文物，应该说是啊，没有什么人注意它的。我当时是在收藏那个广彩的时候，跟那些就古玩商啊是认识了以后，我就发现他们有些这些画，所以呢我就收藏了一些，就是哎呀那个小小的，我记得我买的第一幅那个通草画，好像就小的，好像就几百块钱，很便宜，对呀、啊，可能他们也不认识这是什么东西， 所以哎，我就买回去，我是研究，后来就看了我们城管出的那本书，哈哈，我知道哎，原来通草画是这样一个情况啊，在我们中国已经消失了很长时间啊，最后呢，城管呢在英国的朋友的专线下呢，最后我们重新发现了从通草画这种文化啊，所以就很有意思，所以呢，我就想，哎呀，这样我也应该要系列的去收藏这个东西啊，所以呢，就，我的收藏呢，应该是有从刚才说eBay，我没有在eBay那里买啊，真的，因为我们中国这里eBay不方便。对，我们呢就是有几个途径啊，一个呢是我们广州呢很多这种就是古玩商，他们呢都全世界去跑啊。我可以叫他们帮我买。另外一种呢，我也去那个，我也到外国去拍卖也有啊，但是不多，因为我时间不多，我去外国的时间不多啊。还有啊，老布啊，老布是我的一个很大的一个，哎，一个供应商啊，他的产品啊。又好又多，真的是，我去了他家里看了以后呢，哇，真的是大开眼界啊，很多，很多通草画的，题材啊，我都没见过，真的非常精彩啊。他不单只在他家里，我不单只买过通草画，还买过油画啊，还买过玻璃画，是吧？哎，他也帮我买过扇子，有刺绣，什么都帮我找过，哎，真的非常感谢老布啊，非常感谢，我对，非常感谢，非常感谢。我说。
I wanted to ask you, do you have a favorite type? I mean, do you prefer, jiaju or suqi or what, or is it all the same?
都喜欢，应该说都喜欢。其实呢，都是这样，收藏呢，它会有一个波一个波的。这段时间对瓷器研究的时候呢，就天天收瓷器啊，特别喜欢瓷器，天天研究找文献啊，什么都是瓷器为主。那段时间研究通草画呢，就天天都研究通草画啊，所以呢，它是一波一波的，所以呢。现在呢，就是我家里呢摆的更多的确实是广彩吧，应该说是，因为它可以陈列啊，它可以陈列嘛，是吧？也有挂，通草画也有挂，对呀、啊，广绣啊，因为广绣呢一般比较大，所以呢，摆出来呢不好展示，所以呢广绣呢就小一点，有是有，但是。主要就是通草画跟广彩多一点。
I think, as far as I'm concerned, this has been the most instructive and informative and also beautiful, morning that we've seen wonderful things. We have learnt wonderful things, and, it's been a huge pleasure. Now we're supposed to have a Q&A with the audience, which looks a bit terrifying because there are 79.things in the chat room.
我能不能插一句先讲一两句
Is anyone going to help me?
Yes.
我能不能先讲两句
Okay.
要说两句好好好说
对这个首先我真的非常高兴今天能够参加从通草画到十三行分享海上丝绸之路的故事的云端交流讲座活动我觉得特别有意义因为刚才听了大家的这个这个讲座以后啊给我有很大的一些启发同时我想借这个机会啊也看看这个刚才老布先生介绍的有几件东西正好是我们在广州这边是缺的一个是刚才他提到的这个消防的救火的一个场景还有他在这个讲座中提到的一些南美洲的一些人物的一些画面我想这些希望这个老布啊能够把这些留将来有机会留给广州这个那重新回流到广州来因为这个正是我们这边的 博物馆这个 缺的一段东西。啊，谢谢。
Well, I completely agree. That's absolutely right. So long live Guangdong, Guangdong and Guangdong handicrafts and arts and history, and let's more study of that wonderful subject. So shall I dare to look at the chat and see what sort of questions there are? Gosh, I want to find really sort of questions, ideally.
Francis, may I take the liberty to ask the first question?
Yes. Yes.
Thank you for sharing this. It's really informative. You know, I have to say, I've been so ignorant. You know, I've been to British Library. I know the export paint, and I know piece paper paint, but I never managed to understand, you know, they are of the same purpose. And I never realized the importance of a piece paper painting among all export paintings. So can you please shed some light on, you know, the significance of a piece paper painting, you know, among all exported artworks, especially, you know, the collections British Library has?
Alastair, are you going to, I mean, the British Library has only a couple of Pith paper albums. We've had one for many years about the evils of opium, and that was obviously produced especially for, I think probably for Western missionaries who wanted to talk about the horrors of opium and how it should be combated and so on. We've got another album of ships, but nothing to compare with Alistair's collection, for example, or any of the other collections that we've seen. And I think one of the problems is the question of how to preserve the albums. That if the paintings come in albums, as Alistair said, it's difficult to, you know, turning the pages is dangerous because the paper is so cracks so easily. And I was quite impressed with Alistair's use of frames. I mean, because keeping the thing absolutely still is very good. So they're difficult things to own. And really, it would be interesting to hear from all three experts how they think that Pith paper paintings can be kept and used in museums and libraries.
Indeed.
I'd like to answer that one, if I may, Francis, first of all. It's not always an easy decision to take an antique painting, particularly a delicate antique painting, out of its frame. But the truth of the matter is that if the painting was framed, then it is actually damaging the Pith paper. And without any kind of intervention, that Pith paper will deteriorate over time in its current circumstances. So often, regrettably, the first thing that we do is take it out of the frame and remove any contact with the painting that may be now producing chemicals that are affecting the quality of the Pith painting itself. We then leave it in a dry area to completely dry of moisture, because the Pith paper is very does not react well to excess moisture, like most paper. And then we put a conservation paper behind it. And then finally, we reframe it in as sympathetic a way as we can and completely seal it so that there is no moisture, no air, and we keep it stored in a poorly lit area, sometimes the dark, in order to maintain and preserve the vibrant colors of the gouache that sits on the Pith paper.
Thank you.
So that's how we go about it.
Thank you. 另外我有一点算是今天学习的体会和观察吧，跟大家特别是中国朋友分享。那么像程先生和王先生可以看到我的这个背景，这个广彩的屏。那这我叫 Kevin， 随松岩。那后边的 China Hour 呢，是我在英国天空卫视上边的节目。我们现在呢就正在播一个国内的纪录片系列，就是讲的十三行。 那现在我这个背景呢，就是我们最近在伦敦市中心的那个 Leicester Square 做的我们这个节目的广告，这个也是我们跟伦敦旅游办合作的一个项目。我真的很高兴今天能有机会认识各位，然后能给我们的这个节目又增加一个新的这个内容，一个 dimension。跟那个王先生说一句呢，就是我以前在 BBC 工作过，我也有一个很小的这个音响设备的收藏，以后我们可以交流。
好。
其实还有一个我觉得我以前不知道通草画是又从中国回到了英国。这让我想起了另一个又相关又不相关的故事，就是中国的麋鹿是在中国灭绝之后又从英国重新引回到中国的。所以从麋鹿的故事，从通草画的故事，我就想到其实伦敦旅游办事处做的这个在英国重新发现中国的这个系列真的是太有意义了。可能我们还有更多更多值得我们重新发现，值得我们重新引回到中国， reintroduce back to China 的这样的话题也好，还是产品也好。非常感谢薛主任，也感谢各位专家。
Thank you very much, Heddy. There are a few questions, I mean, some of which are sort of, as it were, being answered as we speak. I mean, there have been questions about whether the painters were Westerners or Chinese. 就是绘画家是不是中国人还是外国人？
Francis, I think before the question, I think we have limited time. Maybe one more question, the last one, right?
Yes, because I can't get through 77. Yes. Yeah. Well, but I think it's fair to talk about that. Yes. Yeah. Were they Westerners or were they Chinese who painted the paintings? This is just a question that came.
I'll answer that one quickly, if I may. They were most definitely Chinese. Now, there is a whole story about how there was a transference of English painting, Western painting skills to Chinese artists. And there are some major characters in that story. But the point that, that answers the question is those were Chinese artists trained and studying, often in a large studio of painters, and they would progress up the ranks from juniors to seniors in those studios.
And of course, brilliantly serving their chosen audience. You know, they made what people wanted. Yeah. 什么？对对。
可以吧？我补充一句。
看了，当然。
这个除了这个中国画家，后来我们也发现了，在英国也有画家在画这个通草画，而且呢，应该很明显的看到有些画作。可能是中小学生来画的，这非常有趣的事情。
On that fantastic note, then perhaps I can hand over for the closing remarks on this very packed and very informative session. Thank you very much for listening.
Thank you, Francis, and thank you, our expert, because we are really, you know, there are so much for us to listen and to enjoy. So I think for those not yet answered questions, you may send your question or your remarks to our email, cntoldn@chinaculture.org. Your questions will also be forwarded, I mean, to our speakers and expert. And, we have a special audience from Guangdong who reached, you know, me last night via WeChat, Ms. Lily, a chief editor of the researching of Guangzhou export painting, who would like to say a few words before finally I hand over to the closing address of the cultural councillor. So Lily, can you briefly, very short, okay, we've got limited time. Yeah.
好，能听到吗？你好，能听到吗？啊，你好，你好，大家好，我是 来自广州十三行博物馆的发起人和策展人李黎，很高兴听了几位专家的分享。那么今天的主题呢是通草画与十三行啊，从通草画到十三行，大家谈了很多的通草画，所以呢我说说十三行吧。因为呢十三行呢这段历史呢它是全球的，为什么这么说？因为它是通过大航海时代西方人来到东方，首次在政治、经济、文化、宗教、科技、语言、艺术、法律、医学、教育全方位融合的地方，就是在十三行，也是第一次。所以呢刚才几位专家讲的这些文物啊，全部都散落在当时出口的这些外销艺术品，欧美各个国家的博物馆以及大学里面都有收藏。不仅是这样，而且还有很多记录大航海时代整个全球贸易的这样的一些历史。你比如说我们十三行博物馆就出啊这个四册的清代广州十三行的这个编年史略，把220年每天发生的事情就记录了下来。另外呢还有一些珐琅彩啊等等研究。所以这十年的博物馆呢，刚才王恒先生也讲了，2016年呢开放以后呢，像英国的肯特郡王子王妃，还有法国总理等等啊，许多的专家学者和政要都来博物馆啊，来看到这一段辉煌的时代。因为目前我们博物馆呢，我也想跟大家介绍一下，除了这些艺术品以外呢，我们现在还做几件事情。一个呢就是这里呢曾经是世界的奢侈品制造和奢侈品贸易的中心达100年啊，这是一段辉煌的历史，也是海上丝绸之路最为繁盛的一段历史，而且还是中国在海上贸易2000年来唯一没有中断过的一条航线，所以它的世界意义是非常广泛的。2019年呢，我们英国国家学术院的院士，我们英国剑桥大学王子学院的终身院士教授艾伦先生呢，亲自率队啊到我们这里来考察。考察完以后，他对我们这个博物馆的建立呢给予高度的肯定。他认为这里呢展示了这个大航海时代东西方文明这样子贸易啊这样的一个展示的重要的平台。但是呢他也认为就是我们现在十三行博物馆5000件套文物95%以上全部是王恒和冯杰伉俪无偿捐赠的。刚才那个主持人也在说啊，你是把他带回了家乡，他不仅把他带回了家乡，还啊无偿的捐给了社会，非常了不起。那么我们现在呢跟剑桥大学和我们十三行博物馆正在筹备的一个事情，就是要把十三行全球的这样一个博物馆联合起来，通过高科技和数字的手段，让我们没有办法把这么多的当时代的奢侈品和艺术品以及中外艺术融合在一起，这样见证的这些外销艺术品能够通过这个平台展示出来啊，这个呢现在还不能公布，大概在明年上半年我们将会啊向公众公布。我们也很期待跟英国剑桥大学呢有更好的这样深度的合作。谢谢大家。
Thank you, Lily. Okay, we are very short of time. Okay, it's exactly you finished that. Okay, last, we would like to invite the cultural councillor, Mr. Minister Yu Peng, to say a few words.
Many thanks, Francis.And many thanks to Alastair, Director Cheng, Cunjie, and Mr. Wang Heng, and Councillor Li Li for such an interesting and informative panel discussion, comments, and Q&A. Many thanks also to Saku for your support with circulating the information of the event, and to the UK Research and Development Center for Chinese Traditional Culture and China Travel Service Information Center for the co-initiating and co-presenting this edition of Rediscover China in the UK with CNTU London. this talk is very beautiful, interesting, and informative, but it is also an inspiring panel discussion of illumination, illustrating role. It proves once again that intercultural exchange and mutual learning do help with mutual knowledge and understanding. It serves as a graphic illustration for the Silk Road spirit, which includes peace and cooperation, openness and inclusivity, and mutual learning and benefits. And today's event also marks the end of our 3 months campaign called All Under One Moon. Dennis, are you ready? Let's give a quick look back of the 5 groups that is made up this, yes. Group number one is historical China. And here you can see rediscovered China in the UK started much earlier. And what we see here is our October edition. As Xueling mentioned just now, it is about the Chinese wallpapers in the UK, the National Trust property. We go up, Dennis Fraser, please, yes. And this is our collaborative part, is collaborative China. And we have here down the, down one page down. Here is the Phil Uglan, a renowned British director of and a winner of BAFTA and Emmy. And he is now working with Chinese counterpart in Qinghai, China, for a documentary series, The Cradle of Nature, featuring our national nature reserve, the biodiversity, work. And down there, yes. And this is the between the cities of Changsha in China and the city of Bristol in and West England in Britain. They are working on a documentary to promote the cultural and tourist destination. Now we go up and up to the group of this one, Wider China. This part, you see this as documentary series made by the British award winner, Malcolm Clark. It is called Chai Mi You Yan Zhi Shang, and the English long cherished dream on the Sky TV's China Hour in October. And down there, you see the WTM World Travel Market London. And there are 50 best practices of using tourism to revitalize our rural area. The cases are both at the WTM website and the CNTU's social platform available there. And up there, here is the Creative China. Of course, we have this Chinese participation into this year's London Craft Week and Create Day. And in addition to that, we have more creative things in relation with our daily life. For example, our kuklong here, Chinese kuklong, yes, and using the nearest, the easy to get ingredient to make this Chinese food during the lockdown when the international travel is restricted. Down there, we have, this is our November edition of Rediscover China in the UK. This is a food talk, between Shandong province and here. So we up there, we move up to finally is Festival China. I won't, this is the hub of the, all the excellent performances which give the audience here in this country an opportunity to enjoy the Chinese Mid-Autumn Festival while at home and during the pandemic. Finally, I would like to see that once again, many thanks for today's talk, which serves simply a perfect finale for this All Under One Moon. Thank you all and have a good weekend. Thank you.
Thank you. That's the end of the talk. Thank you all. Stay tuned and see you next time. Bye-bye.